Cenk, you've been focused on the backdoor bailout. It's a story, you know, again, it's one of those stories mainstream media just has dropped the ball on. I mean, how could we lose $13 billion to some bottom feeders like Goldman Sachs and nobody be upset by this story?
It's shocking to me. And maybe I should stop being shocked because everybody seems to be in on it.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's Washington or Wall Street or it's the government or the media, and they seem, you know, unaffected. They're like, oh, $13 billion on a side bet, went out the window. Well, of course the American taxpayer should pay for that.
Lay the story out for us a little bit. You know, it really is nothing more than a side bet with all the odds being controlled by Goldman Sachs, is it?
Yeah, in some ways, of course, it's actually worse because Goldman Sachs is the one that set up the assets in the first place. $23 billion worth of toxic assets that they gave to AIG that they then bet against. So they're the ones who set up the crooked bet in the first place. And then when those assets crash, they go to AIG and say, well, we made a bet with you that they would crash, and now you got to pay us. Well, okay, look, so far you say, okay, look, everybody's having fun. It's a crooked casino, but AIG decided to play in it. And that's their problem, not our problem. And, you know, capitalism, baby, right? Except AIG, it turns out, doesn't have any money. And Goldman Sachs knew they didn't have any money. And that's why they, you know, bragged about how they had counterparties to AIG, if AIG went under. So this is where the story should have ended, where Goldman Sachs tries to get insurance on AIG, probably doesn't, and maybe rescues 20 cents on the dollar of their bet.
And tries to make it sound like that's a big deal. You know, I got to tell you something. This is another deal that you have this thug, Hank Paulson, you know, making money at what this is not the first time he made $700 million. He made that earlier, I think, when he made the same kind of deal before he became he was at Goldman before he became Treasury Secretary. And so this is the same guy in charge of this deal, really, isn't it? I mean, isn't he kind of at the heart of this?
So, yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, here comes another twist, right? So Goldman Sachs shouldn't have been paid on this by the taxpayers, obviously. They had nothing to do with this. But if AIG had won the bet, we wouldn't have won. You know, executives who get to collect their bonuses either way. Instead, when they lose, they turn around, and guess who's at the Treasury? But the former CEO of Goldman Sachs,
right,
who winds up thinking it's a brilliant idea to pay off bets that, you know, my friends made and the same kind of bets he used to make, that's why he made $700 million on these same kind of bets.
Right.
And he says, yeah, I'm going to take the taxpayer money and pay you guys off with it. And it's insane, except everybody treats it like it's sane.
Well, look, I've heard you say, and this is really good analogy, it's like, Would you go to Las Vegas and walk into the Bellagio and say, look, I don't really care whether government is controlling this gaming system. I'm just going to go in there and I'm going to throw myself at the mercy and the credibility of the people behind the roulette wheel. I mean, would you do that? That's a question I've heard you say. Would you do that? And everyone, hell no. None of us are going to do that. But that's what we've done here, isn't it?
There's no question about it. And it's a friend of mine once went to a Filipino casino, and he says it's hilarious how rigged it is because the dealers will reach into a bag to grab a card. You know, all the cards are set in the bag. They know where they are, et cetera. It's so obvious that it's rigged. And we have walked into a Filipino casino, and we're the suckers at the table.
Yeah.
They just keep taking our money. And look, here's another quick analogy. So the Boston plays the Lakers last night, and I make a bet with you, and it turns out we bet $1 million, but I only got $10 to my name. It was, you know, I'm a deadbeat. You go come to collect, find out I don't have the money, and then since I don't have it, you collect it from Bob, Steve, Susie, and Sally. They're like, wait a minute. I didn't make the bet. Why are you collecting for me?
It was, yeah.
You know?
Or better yet, after they find out you don't have money, they put a life insurance policy out on you and then off you when you walk out. I mean, that's how ugly this is. Look, one thing for sure, people don't know the history of Hank Paulson. You and I do because we talk about this all the time. I mean, look, this is a guy who was assistant to John Ehrlichman. There was some thought during the Watergate era. There's some thought this guy should have gone to prison along with the rest of the Watergate folks. But he got out. He wasn't convicted of conspiracy and perjury and obstruction of justice for his, you know, for what Ehrlichman did. But he worked for the guy. Then he goes on and he becomes credible all of a sudden. They put him in charge of defense. And, you know, but nobody knows the story about Hank Paulson, but he's always behind these kinds of things. And then you got Tim Geithner. Tell us about Geithner. Why is it that nobody goes after this little freak? I mean, he's tied into Wall Street as closely. He's always been tied into Wall Street, but he's so tied in that there's no way he can be objective in anything he does. Tell us your take on Tim Geithner.
Tim Geithner is the perfect tool of Wall Street. I mean, the word tool is just perfect to describe him. And they use him as such, and he's happy to be used as such. So when he was at the New York Fed, Paulson comes to him, and Goldman comes to him, who are his top advisors. His top advisors are all the top bankers. And shockingly enough, the top bankers advise them to give all the money, taxpayer money, over to them. And he falls for it hook, line, and sinker. I don't know if he's, you know, in on it or if he's just one of the dumbest guys in America, but they tell him, even though the market says that these assets are worth 20 cents on the dollar, you should pay us 100 cents on the dollar because we've got you over a barrel. Now, wait a minute. They didn't have us over a barrel. We had them over a barrel.
Sure.
We got to close.
I mean, exactly. We had control of both companies, if you think about it. It was no problem. We didn't have to. The worst thing is Geithner was told, I mean, he's been told on several occasions, just like the rest of the American public. Goldman says, we don't even need the damn money. We don't even need it. Take it. We don't need it.
Yeah, absolutely. They said, yeah, look, we don't need it from the federal government. We actually can get it from other parties that we bet had insurance against AIG because we, you know, we knew what a mess AIG was. And so we thought they couldn't pay our bets. So we made bets with other people saying, if AIG can't pay, you're going to pay us anyway. So, but they say that conveniently after they already got the taxpayer money. Like, we didn't need it anyway, so just get off us, right? I mean, don't bother us.
Well,
if I was Tim Geithner and you say, oh, you didn't need it? Oh, my bad. Then all right.
Well,
they
said that to defend themselves. It was like, no, we didn't do anything wrong because we didn't need that. But, you know, you follow the money on it. It all goes back to Tim Geithner's decision.